All right, so where we left off last time, we just talked about the Java virtual machine and talked about how Android had a couple of different virtual machines, something called Dalvik, and then something that's called Arc for the Android runtime. Irrespective of whether you have Arc or you have the Java Dalvik virtual machine, there are a number of Java class libraries that come along for the ride. So if you're a user of Android, then most of the Java libraries that you will come to know and love by just being a vanilla Java programmer are also available to you. So things in java.lang, things in Java util, and so on and so forth. You can take a look at this link to find out more information that compares and contrasts Java versus Android. But for the most part, they're very, very similar. So once you know one, it's easy to use the other. Some of the most interesting things that Java provides is its support for multi-threading. And one of the really cool things about the way we're doing the class now with Java is it makes it possible to cover multi-threading much earlier in the curriculum in computing than we would have done in the past. So you probably wouldn't have gotten exposed much to multi-threading in the past till you got to the OS course, which just comes junior year or later. So now we're going to be able to cover this early because Java has really nice support for threads and it's easy to learn. So a thread in Java is a unit of computation that runs in the context of something called a process. So remember our discussion from a couple days ago when I was here last week, we talked about processes being units of protection and resource allocation, and inside of the processes, threads can execute. And you can read about threads here for more information about threading. So the threads that run within the processes are able to communicate with each other in various ways. And there's a couple of different techniques you can use. If you're talking between threads that are in the same process, which is very, very common, then those threads can communicate with each other either by setting variables that they both have access to or by passing messages back and forth. And we'll end up covering both approaches. The approach that's most common in Android programs is by passing messages back and forth. And we'll talk shortly about ways to do that. If you start talking between threads in different processes on the same machine, then something called inter-process communication is used, which is another form of message passing to move the information back and forth across the process boundaries. And we'll talk lots about that later in the course as well. We'll also talk about ways in which you communicate between a process on your Android device and a process that might run out in the cloud somewhere, like on a server, or maybe just another process on your laptop when you run your device in the emulator mode or so on. And as we'll see later on, those also use message passing communications. Each Java thread has a bunch of interesting state. Some of the state in the Java thread is unique to the thread. In other words, each thread has its own unique state. So examples of things like that would be the stack of activation records. Activation records correspond to the function calls that are invoked or method calls that are invoked when your program is running. It's part of what's called the runtime stack. And so each thread has a stack. Each thread also has a program counter and other registers which keep track of where the thread is in its computation, executing a stream of instructions, which in this case would be typically Java bytecode or the Android equivalent of bytecode. And so that's typically what's unique to each thread. And then there's also some data that's shared across threads within a process. So static data, things like static fields that are part of classes that have the right visibility can be shared across threads. Of course, you have to protect them carefully with synchronizers and so on, or volatile keywords. And there's also support for the heap, which is the way that you allocate memory when you say new. So in Java, when you say new thread or new vector or new array or whatever you're newing, that's making something that's coming to you off the heap, which is a shared area of memory that all threads can nominally get access to, modulo certain other kinds of things we'll talk about later. So those are important distinctions: shared state, unique state. Those are different kinds of things that go into threads. Now, the tricky part about threads, just like so many other things in life, is it's easy to set them in motion, but once they're in motion, you have to be careful how they interact with each other. How many people here have ever driven in India before? Okay. So everybody understands who's ever driven in India. I've been to India before. When you drive in India, each person with a car is actually, it's quite an amazing thing to watch, because everybody's like absolutely jammed close to each other, but there are relatively few fender bender accidents given how closely people drive to each other. And so the point there is that you need some way of synchronizing things. And it's the same thing almost everywhere you go with automobiles. What are some things we use to synchronize the flow of traffic? Traffic lights, stop signs, those are things we use. So synchronizers are used to avoid so-called race conditions. And we'll talk a lot more about race conditions later, but race conditions are basically problems that occur when two or more threads try to access the same state without proper protection. And so bad things happen. We'll talk a lot about that at a later point in the course. So synchronization mechanisms are used to prevent this. We'll talk more about Java synchronization mechanisms later. This particular class is not going to go into a lot of detail about synchronization mechanisms. The CS282 class will go into a lot more detail, and CS281 goes into more detail. We will cover them a little bit, though. All right, so that's just a quick overview of some of the core Java-related runtime features that come with Android. Now, there's also a bunch of things that sit on top of the core Java classes that are centric to Android. So almost everything we just talked about, like threads and so on, those are things you find in any Java environment. The next set of discussions we're going to have are the Android-centric things. And you can see there's a pretty gigantic list of them. A lot of the things, as you might not be surprised to know, are graphical user interface related, because that's a big thing you do with your phone, is show people graphical ways to interact with it. There's also a bunch of things that deal with networking, a bunch of connectivity stuff, a bunch of system-related APIs, things that deal with the operating system, which in this case are really more frameworks for interacting with the operating system, databases, all kinds of crazy stuff. And then there's also a bunch of application-related things as well. So content providers and services and other things. So we'll talk a lot about this as we go through the class. One of the most interesting set of things we're going to focus on in this course will be the Android concurrency frameworks, which are frameworks that are focused on the types of design constraints that Android imposes upon developers. And we'll talk a lot more later about what it's doing. There are two particular frameworks we're going to focus on in this class, and in fact, your next programming assignment, you'll get to use at least one of them. The first one is the Handlers, Messages, and Runnables framework, or the Hammer framework, as I like to call it. And the Hammer framework is what you get to do if you're doing the undergrad version of the next programming assignment, unless you choose to do this other framework we'll talk about next. And so the Hammer framework basically makes it possible to spawn one or more background threads to do long-running computations off the main thread of control. And as those long-running computations finish, there's a nice convenient way to pass the results of those long-running computations to the user interface thread for them to be displayed to the user. So if you take a look and you watch the video for the next programming assignment, assignment number 3, you'll see that what you do in that assignment is you type in a URL to an image you want to download, and the image is then downloaded to your device and stuck into the file system, and then you have the gallery application open up and display the image you downloaded. And we'll talk more about all that stuff later, but the key point is that when you download an image, that's a potentially long-running thing, because the network might be slow, the image might be big, whatever, or there might be other things going on the phone, so it takes a while to run. So that downloading of the image has to run in the background, in a background thread. So one way to do that is to use the Hammer framework. And if you read the index.html file that describes the assignment, you'll see that it provides some links to other videos that cover these frameworks. Now, we're going to cover them in class, but if you want a little preview, you can watch those videos. They're like 6 minutes long. They're not very long. The second form of concurrency framework we're going to cover, which the grad students have to implement for assignment number 3, is called the Async Task Framework. And the Async Task Framework does many things similarly to the Hammer framework, the main difference being that it's a little bit more object-oriented in the way it works. And so you have to subclass from it, fill in a few hook methods, and then create an instance of one of these async tasks, and it does all the magic in the background with callouts to certain hook methods and so on. So it's really cool. We'll cover both of those things. Undergrads can do either one. Grad students have to do the Async Task Framework. So we'll talk a lot about concurrency frameworks, really powerful features. The great thing about using Java and Android is we can talk about this stuff much earlier than we could later because it's built in so nicely. Yes, sir? Oh, great question. So the question is, what if you're on a single CPU machine, do you get any win from using concurrency? Does anybody want to take a shot at answering that question before I take my shot at it? Yes, sir. Sam. So there could be multiple threads, but I think the question is, you know, what good is it for there to be multiple threads if there's only one CPU doing the work? So that's the main question. Does anybody want to guess at what that is? Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry?
Organization.
So organization, that's a very good answer. So one thing we'll see that by the use of multi-threading, we can often simplify our program structure even if the program itself doesn't run any faster. And when we get a little bit further along, I'll give you a whole discussion about this. If you take a look at the index.html file, though, one of the videos I point you to is called Motivations for Concurrency or something like that, and that explains the three main motivations for concurrency. Performance boost, responsiveness boost, and simplify program structure. So program organization falls under that category. So those are the three main reasons. But let's go back to the original question. Yes, sir? Right, so I think your answer is actually similar to her answer, which is if you use multi-threading, then even if there's only one CPU, you can have a blocking operation downloading and processing something like an image without perturbing the way in which you program the interactions with the user. And so that's both a simplifying program structure argument, and it's also a responsiveness argument because you can be responsive to the user even though something else is going on. But there actually is a potential reason why you would still get a boost on a single CPU machine, i.e. one CPU, if you have multiple threads. Does anybody know why you might improve performance even though there's only one CPU? Yes, sir?
Hyper-threading,
yes, although that's a hardware solution. Let's assume there really is one and only one CPU, and it's your grandfather's phone, so it's like 20 years old, and it only has one thread or one hardware thread. Yeah?
Can it have robustness if one process collapses?
So robustness is a good thing, although that isn't necessarily directly related to performance. But yes, robustness is a very good reason too. That's actually why you typically have multiple processes, by the way, not so much multiple threads. But yeah?
Maybe CPU limits how much computation a thread can.
So there's an observation. Does a CPU limit how much? Well, there is, although that doesn't really help with the performance rationale. Yeah?
If one thread is waiting for a response from something else, then the other thread could run.
Right. Very good. That's the win. So if you have multiple threads, if you have only one thread of control, and that thread were to block waiting for something, like downloading a file, then everything else would come to a screeching halt while it sat there waiting for that thing to finish. But of course, waiting for something is an eternity to a computer. A computer is doing millions or hundreds of millions of instructions per second, right? So why the heck would you want it to sit there waiting? So when you have multiple threads, if one thread blocks on a long-running operation like I/O, that guy can be parked virtually while another thread is able to run and make progress because maybe what it's doing isn't blocked for whatever reason. So that's a way to get a speed up. So you can actually have things run faster with multiple threads, even though there's only one CPU, because when something goes to block, it only blocks that thread, not all the threads. And so other threads may be able to make progress. So that's one of the major performance benefits. And we'll talk a lot more about this later. OK, so those are the concurrency frameworks. We're going to cover them a lot more as the class goes on. Another set of things that Android provides are something called services, which are basically units of programming abstraction that allow computation and communication to run in the background. And the way typically you do this, because you want to have certain things that are able to run without requiring the user to actually be interacting with the service. And when we start talking in more specifics about Android components, you'll see why we need this kind of behavior. And we'll examine lots of source code. You can download all the source code here. I recommend you take a look at the source code at some point. It's very fascinating, and we'll cover some of it through the discussions. Okay, next topic. Most applications in Android are written in Java. However, most of the libraries that those applications call, most of the Java class libraries or the Android class libraries, many of those functions in those libraries are actually not implemented in Java, but instead they're implemented in C and C++, and they're available to the Java layer via the Java Native Interface. And the Java Native Interface basically provides a way for managed code written in Java, that is code that has all the good properties we come to know and love with Java, like strong type checking and range checking and avoiding problems with pointers going berserk and so on. All those types of things we come to know and love with Java are still there, except the implementations of the methods are written in C and C++, which are a lot more efficient and use resources better in terms of time and space, typically. That's a bit of an overstatement, but it's not too far from the truth. By the way, someone asked an excellent question at the end of the class the other day, which is, you have all these layers in Android. How do they talk to each other? And so we'll see as we go through the course that often you'll have the higher layer stuff, which is like the application code, making method calls, and those things, of course, call Java to Java code. And then at some point, those Java method calls use the Java Native Interface in order to interact with lower level, in quotes, code written in C and C++. And sometimes that code is also user level code, and sometimes that code is actually code that runs in the context of the operating system kernel. And again, without getting too far off into the weeds of what's covered in the OS course, the operating system kernel has a set of things called system calls or system functions. And so when the C and C++ code calls into the operating system APIs, there's what's called a mode switch from user mode to kernel mode, and then there's processing that takes place inside the protected domain of the OS kernel. So that's typically how calls start out of the Java layer in the application and wind their way down through the system libraries into C and C++ code into the operating system kernel, which is typically written in C. So that's one of the paths of going between the layers. And then there's also communication that takes place between address spaces, and they can use various inter-process communication mechanisms, which we'll cover later. So we'll cover a lot of this stuff later in the course, but that's a quick crash overview of how the layers talk to each other. Now, in addition to providing Java interfaces to native C and C++ code, it's also possible, although not widely done by most programmers, to write entire applications in C and C++. And to do this requires the use of something called the Native Development Kit, the NDK. And that's described here. And that allows you to implement your entire app, or a big portion of your app, using native code. And the reason for doing this is to minimize latency, maximize throughput, conserve resources, time, space, power, and so on. Very rare you need to do this in practice. The only reason you would ever write code in C and C++ in Android in practice is if you were writing sort of system services, you were developing like a security manager or some other kind of powerful service for downloading of things or whatever. Or maybe if you wrote a big application and you profiled it and you found it was just too slow in Java. But that's rare these days. Here are some of the many C and C++ libraries that Android provides to you. So for example, the systemc library, so-called libc, which provides you C interfaces to many Unix system services, things like threads and processes and managing address boundaries and all kinds of other stuff that you would get if you were a native C and C++ developer writing apps on Linux. There's also something called the Media Framework, which is written in C and C++ and does audio-video streaming. So when you do things like play music or watch movies or so on, the Media Framework is used under the hood to do all that kind of stuff. And that's very computationally intensive processing, so C and C++ is the appropriate choice for that. There's something called WebKit, which is an interesting open source toolkit or framework for building browser interactions and interfaces provided by Apple, of all people, written in C and C++. There's something called OpenGL, which provides 2D and 3D vector graphics. There's something called SQLite, which is a relational database engine that's used to store and retrieve persistent information. You'll get some chances to play with that later in the course. And then something else called the secure socket layer, which is used to ensure confidentiality and integrity for various kinds of e-commerce applications where you're paying for things with your credit card over your smartphone connected to a server in the cloud or something like that. So those are examples of some of the many, many different C and C++ libraries that come with Android by default. And you can find out more about the NDK here if you're curious about it. The last set of things we'll cover at this point with the overview, two more things, the application framework layer and then the packaged applications layer, all of which, of course, reside on top of everything else we've just covered. So the application framework layer actually provides a bunch of frameworks. I don't know why they don't call it the application frameworks layer because it's really more than one. But they're basically services that are essential to the Android platform. So for example, the window manager, the thing that manages the windows and gives you the look and feel that you come to expect when you play around with a mobile device or any kind of device where you have to manage windows and borders and buttons and so on. Something called the package manager, which is how you install the applications. When you guys start to develop your own Android applications using Eclipse or Android Studio, you'll see that it's really cool, actually. You write your application, you get it compiled, and then you say, run as. And depending on how you have things configured, either to use the Android emulator or an actual smartphone connected via a USB cable, it will go ahead and actually create a package, which is sort of an executable that keeps all the information needed to run the application. And it downloads that into your phone or your emulator using the package manager, which keeps track of all the information and the metadata that your application needs in order to run. There's something called the telephony manager, which is actually the thing that actually keeps track of the telephone and the radio, so you can make calls and you can do various things when calls come in and so on. Very, very important part of the application framework layer is called the activity manager. That's the thing that manages all the various lifecycle callbacks that you guys will come to know and love as you start doing assignment number 3. And it also handles all kinds of other communication between services and broadcast receivers and other things we'll talk about later. And then something else that really gives mobile phones some of their coolness is a location manager that keeps track of where you are. So you can use that, of course, with things like Google Maps in order to do navigation or wayfinding or get a view of where you are, or where you want to go, and things like that. So those are some of the things that are available on the phone. And they just make your life easier as a developer of applications. And we'll talk about other stuff as we go through this. And then finally, last but not least, are some of the packaged applications. These are the things that come in open source form along with Android. There's about 24 packaged applications. Here are some of them. So things like the home screen, which is what you see when you start up your phone, the contacts database you use to keep track of your friends, calendar, camera, the phone application to dial numbers and call from contacts, web browser, email readers, email senders like Gmail and Mail, media players of various kinds of things, and of course everybody's favorite SMS and MMS to waste your life texting to each other. So lots of good stuff comes built in, and you can actually look at the source code for all this stuff and see how it works. All these apps are written in Java, although internally there are lots and lots of calls to JNI taking place under the hood. And not surprisingly, as we'll also discover later, these packaged apps use a lot of concurrency and communication mechanisms to do their job. So we'll cover some of this stuff later in the course. You'll get a chance to build your own apps. Your assignment number 3 gives you a chance to build an application using existing pieces of existing applications that already come defined out of the box on Android, which is really cool because it's a good example of systematic reuse and frameworks and some of the abstract topics we've talked about. Okay, anybody have any questions about the overview?